Hello, welcome to the class on E540 Advanced Electromagnetic Theory and Antennas. I am Professor Rakesh Singh Chaturmeva. So in this class, we'll discuss about the wave equation. We'll try to get the wave equation from the Maxwell equations. So once we have the wave equation, we can solve the wave equation in different coordinate system and find the different kind of waves, cylindrical, spherical and the plane waves. So the most important point is how do we get the equation of wave equation from the Maxwell equations. So let us look at the two Maxwell curl equations. So the one of the Maxwell curl equation is curl of E is equal to minus J omega mu I. We are considering it for time harmonic fields, so all the time derivatives has been replaced by J omega here, so we'll call this equation as equation 1. And we also have another Maxwell curl equation, which is curl of H is equal to J omega epsilon E plus J. So now if we take common, electric field is common, so we can take electric field common and we can write it as J omega epsilon plus sigma E. And please note that here we have replaced J by sigma E, so basically we have Ohm's law in point form. Now in the Ohm's law in points form, we can replace the conduction current by sigma E. Sigma is the conductivity, E is the electric field. So now we can write curl of H as J omega epsilon plus sigma E. So we'll call this as equation 2. So point is, how do we get the wave equation from here? So basically what we do, let's say I want to get the wave equation for electric field, then what do? I take the curl of the first equation. Then when I take the curl of the first equation, I will get curl of E, and in the right hand side also I will get minus J omega mu curl of X. So we know what is curl of X from the second equation. So we take the curl of the first equation and substitute the second equation in the right hand side, then we can get the wave equation. That's what exactly we are going to do in this class. So let's see what do we get after doing this process I have mentioned just now. So we take the curl of the first equation. So when I take the curl of the first equation, I will take the curl for the left hand side, also for the right hand side. So let us take the curl for the left hand side. What do I have? Curl of E. So curl of E is basically you use a vector identity. There is a vector identity. You can find the curl of E as del divergence of E minus del square E. So we can find out curl of E like del divergence of E minus del square E. So let's look at it. What is divergence of E? Let's say we are considering wave. So we want to find a wave equation and we are assuming that wave is propagating in free space. So in the free space there are no charges, there are no charge forces. So basically divergence of E should be equal to zero in free space because there are no charges in the free space. It's an infinite free space we are considering where wave is propagating. There are no charges, so this term is zero. So finally curl of E turns out to be minus del square E. Del square we also code it as Laplacian of E. So curl of E turns out to be minus Laplacian of electric field. Let us take the curl in the right hand side also of the equation 1. When I take the curl of the right hand side in the equation 1, what do I get? So I get minus J omega mu curl of X. I know what is curl of I from the second equation we have considered in the previous slide. It was J omega epsilon sigma E. Just replace that. Then finally what we get is curl of H is J omega epsilon plus sigma E. So finally the equation we are getting is, we can write in a very compact form as minus gamma I square E. What is gamma? Gamma is this whole term here, J omega mu J omega epsilon plus sigma. So this is a complex number. Gamma is a complex number. We'll discuss about what is the gamma, what is its real part and imaginary part later on in this class. So this whole term turns up, we can represent it as gamma I square. So the equation for the wave simply becomes Laplacian of electric field minus gamma I square E is equal to zero. So we get the equation of the wave. So we'll see that whether this is really the equation of wave. We'll try to find out the solution of this wave equation and are we getting waves out of this. That's what we're going to see in this class as well as in the subsequent class also. So we get the equation for the wave. We can do the similar thing. So take the curl of the second equation and substitute the first equation. I will get the wave equation for magnetic field. Laplacian of x minus gamma I squared, x is equal to 0. So now look at this wave equation. It's a better wave equation. So electric field is vector, magnetic field is vector. So this Laplacian will operate on this electric field and magnetic field component wise. Electric field, let's say, has Ex, Ey, Ez. This Laplacian operator will operate on Ex, Ey, and Ez components of the electric field. So the equation we are getting is claimed to be as wave equation, del square E minus gamma I square E is equal to 0. Until and unless we solve it and see we get the solution as wave, then we cannot claim this as a wave equation. So let us verify whether we are getting wave out of solving this equation, del square E minus gamma I square E equal to 0. That's what we are going to do now. We'll do that in the Cartesian coordinate system. Cartesian coordinate system is the simplest one. We'll do it for cylindrical and spherical coordinate system later on. So let us do it for the Cartesian coordinate system. Solve this wave equation in the Cartesian coordinate system. And we know that electric field is a vector. It will have three components. As I already told you in the previous slide also, this electric field will operate on the Ex, Ey and Ez component of the this Laplacian will operate on the Ex, Ey and Ez component of the electric field. So electric field will have three components: Ex, x hat is the unit vector along the x axis, ey, y hat is the unit vector along the y axis, ez, z hat is the unit vector along the z axis. So this is the expression for the electric field. So now our Laplacian will operate on both on each component of the electric field, ex, ey and ez. So let us first consider that our Laplacian in the wave equation is operating on the ex component of the electric field vector. So then we can write del square Ex minus gamma I square Ex is equal to 0. What is del square or Laplacian in the Cartesian coordinate system? It's very simple. I think most of you must be knowing. It's del square by del x square plus del square by del y square, del square by del z square. So this Laplacian operator will operate on the Ex component of the electric field. You subtract minus gamma, you subtract gamma I square Ex from that, we should get 0. This is the wave equation. So we want to solve it for the Ex component of the electric field vector. We can solve it by applying a very standard technique we usually use for solving the wave equation, which is called method of separation of variables. So here Ex will have Ex will be actually product of three functions, x, y and z. Capital X is totally dependent on x variable, capital Y is totally dependent on the y variable, capital Z is totally dependent on the z variable. So we have separated the function Ex, which was a function of x, y and z. We have separated the x dependent function, y dependent function and z dependent function. So this is called method of separation of variables. When we do that, what happens to the equation we have for the wave equation? So now, when I do partial double derivative with respect to x of the xyz, y and z are independent of x, so we can take it outside. So what we have is yz del square x by del x square. Similarly, when I do the partial derivative with respect to y, x and z are independent of y, so I can write xz del square y by del y square. Similarly, for the last one, when I do partial derivative with respect to z, x and y are independent of z, so I can take it outside, xy del square z by del z square should be equal to gamma square xyz. We can further simplify this equation by dividing by xyz in both left hand side and right hand side. What do we get? We get 1 by x del square x by del x square plus 1 by y del square y by del y square plus 1 by z del square z by del z square is equal to gamma I square. So now look at this equation we have. The simplification from the wave equation, what you see is left hand side, the first term is totally dependent on the x variable, second term is totally dependent on y variable, and third term is also totally dependent on z variable, and in the right hand side we have a constant gamma I square. So in that case, we can equate this first term 1 by x del square x by del x square as gamma x, another constant, and we can also equate 1 by y del square y with del y square equal to gamma y, another constant, and 1 by z del square z by del z square equal to gamma z, another constant. Looking at this equation we have here, this equation is very familiar to us. What kind of solution this equation will have? Obviously it will have exponential function. So what is the solution for capital X here? It will be a constant Cx exponential plus minus gamma xx. And solution for capital Y will be Cy. Cy is another constant exponential plus minus gamma yy. Z is equal to Cz exponential plus minus gamma zz. So we can start seeing that we are getting the equation of wave now. So now I can write the solution of Ex. We know that Ex was the product of three functions, x, y, and z, and we have already found out what is x, y, and z. So we can write as Cx, Cy, Cz exponential plus minus gamma xx, exponential plus minus gamma yy, exponential plus minus gamma zz. So now this constant Cx, Cy, Cz, when you multiply it, you'll get another constant. I'll denote it by C1. So what we have is, and you know that when you multiply three exponential function, arguments get added up. So the final expression we have for Ex is C1 exponential plus minus gamma xx plus minus gamma yy plus gamma zz. So this is the equation of the wave. So this equation, definitely equation of a wave. We have already seen what is the equation of a plane wave. This looks like equation of a plane wave. Similarly, you can also find out Ey. Ey will turn out to be another constant C2 exponential plus minus gamma xx plus minus gamma yy plus minus gamma zz. Ez will be C3 exponential plus minus gamma xx plus minus gamma yy plus minus gamma zz. So now I can write the expression for the electric field. Now I have Ex component, Ey component, and Ez component. I can simply write, see, the exponential terms are equal for Ex, Ey, and Ez. I can take it out common. So it is exponential plus minus gamma x, x plus gamma y, y plus gamma z, z. And what do we have? We have C1, C2, C3 are the constants. Constants for Ex, Ey, Ez. So now we have a vector here, C1 x hat plus C2 y hat plus C3 z hat. This is a constant vector. Now constant vector, I can represent it by a vector C. So the final expression we have for the electric field is a constant vector C, which will actually decide the polarization of the wave. So basically tip of the electric field will decide polarization of the wave. So electric field here is equal to a constant vector C, which will decide the polarization of the wave, exponential plus minus gamma xx plus gamma yy plus gamma zz. So this is the equation of a plane wave. We can further simplify this expression. You know that gamma vector will have three components in the xyz region. So gamma xx, gamma yy, gamma zz. R vector will also have three component xyz. So now we can express the previous expression of the wave in a very compact form. Electric field vector is equal to C vector, which will decide the polarization of the wave, exponential plus minus gamma dot R, gamma vector dot R vector. This is exactly what equation of the wave we have discussed in the previous class. So you also add the time harmonic field. So time harmonic fields, basically we have suppressed the time dependence exponential j omega t. Now let us add it. So I want to find the variation of electric field with respect to space and time. So I add the time dependence exponential j omega t. So what I have is electric field is C vector exponential j omega t plus minus gamma vector dot R vector. So now you know that this gamma here was a complex number. It will have real part and imaginary part. We usually denote the real part of gamma by alpha. What is this alpha and beta? I will see in the we'll be seeing it very shortly. So gamma was a complex number, so it will have real part. We usually denote real part by alpha and imaginary part by beta. So I can replace this gamma vector by alpha vector plus j beta vector. In that case, I can simplify the expression for time harmonic wave expression as C vector exponential plus minus alpha dot R. Alpha is the real part of the gamma vector and exponential j omega t plus minus beta dot r. Beta is the imaginary part of the beta vector, gamma vector. So taking the real part, let us look at the real part. We are interested in the real part of the wave. So real of electric field will become real of the expression we have just derived. So you know that c vector is a real, so we can take it outside. Exponential plus minus alpha dot r will also be real, so we can take it outside. What we have is exponential j omega t plus minus beta dot r. You take the real part of it, you get cosine of omega t plus minus beta dot r. So what we are seeing now is the equation of the wave. So this equation of the wave, look at the phase of the cosine function here. You have omega t plus minus beta dot r. So it is both dependent on the time and the space variable r. R is the position vector. So now this expression is a vector expression of the wave. So we can make some simplified assumptions and try to understand the wave behavior in a more proper way. So let us first assume that the wave is polarized. Polarized means this wave vector will have only x component of the electric field. Y component and z component will be zero. So it's a major simplification. We assume that electric field is polarized. That means electric field will have only Ex except. And we also assume the wave propagation in the positive z direction. The wave is propagating along the positive z direction. So in that case, gamma vector will also have only z component. Gamma, so there is a typo here, this should be z. Gamma vector should be gamma z, z hat. And gamma is a complex number, it will have real part and imaginary part. Real part we call it alpha z, imaginary part we call it beta z. So I can express gamma z as alpha z plus j beta z, z hat. This should be z hat, it should not be x hat. We have a wave propagating along the z direction. So by making this assumption, we can simplify the expression of the wave equation we have just derived. In this particular case, the wave equation will turn out to be, so now it will have only x component c except. C is any arbitrary constant except. So we have only x component of the electric field and exponential minus alpha z z. This is the first part of the wave expression. We have exponential plus minus alpha dot r. Now with this simplification we have considered, it will be just exponential minus alpha z z and exponential j omega t minus beta z z. So beta dot r will become beta z z. So in this case, you take the real part, what you get, c exponential minus alpha z z cosine of omega t minus beta z z x n. So this is the wave which is propagating along the z direction, that's why we have beta z z, and it has only x component. So x polarized wave, we have c x hat. So this is a wave which is propagating along the z axis and it's polarized along the x axis. So let us look closely. First thing is that you have exponential minus alpha z z here. What is the impact of this on the wave propagation? So we see that we also have, so look at the diagram here. See, when we have considered the plane waves, wave equation, we have shown that the wave amplitude, not peak of the wave amplitude, was always constant. It was always constant. So cos omega t minus beta z z, when you plot it with respect to z axis, it will have a cosine variation, and the peak amplitude of the wave was always constant when we consider the lossless case, when alpha z was zero. That was the case. But when alpha z is greater than zero, what we are saying is that the amplitude of the wave is attenuating very fast. So amplitude of the wave is no more constant, it's attenuating very fast. This is the case when we have a lossy medium. So if we have a lossless medium, alpha z is zero, the amplitude of the wave will be always constant. It will be waveform will be in the form of cosine function, and along the z-axis wave amplitude remains a constant. That was the wave, simple wave we consider in a lossless media. But whenever you have losses, then amplitude of the wave will decay very fast, and you can see that in the right side of the diagram, this diagram here, what you are seeing is that the peak amplitude of the wave is decreasing very fast, attenuating exponentially, it's attenuating. So now that is because of the term we have here, exponential minus alpha z z, and that's why we call this alpha z, which is the real part of the gamma, which was called as propagation constant. Real part of the gamma is called gamma is called propagation constant. Real part of the gamma is called the attenuation constant. Attenuation constant. That is because this alpha z will decide how fast is the attenuation of the wave. Attenuation of the wave is decided by alpha z. That's why we call this real part of gamma as attenuation constant. Similarly, you see here, what you see this phase here. Phase of the wave is decided by beta z here. So due to the movement of the wave along the z axis, there will be some phase change in the wave. That phase change in the wave will be decided with beta z. That's why we call this imaginary part of the gamma as phase constant. So what do we have? Gamma z is the propagation constant. It will give you the behavior of propagation of the wave in the media. And it has real part and imaginary part. Real part is called attenuation constant. It will decide how fast the wave attenuation with respect to distance. And we also have beta z here, imaginary part. It will give you the phase of the wave due to the motion of the wave along the z axis. So we have gamma is the propagation constant, alpha z real part is called the attenuation constant, imaginary part beta z is called the phase constant. So now we have seen that when we solve the wave equation, we in the Cartesian coordinate system, we are getting the expression of plane waves, and we have verified that that wave equation actually is giving waves, no, which are plane wave. We can also solve this wave equation in other coordinate system like spherical coordinate system or cylindrical coordinate system, but the Laplacian in the spherical and cylindrical coordinate expression, I think many of the students won't be able to remember. It's very lengthy. So now, Laplacian in the Cartesian coordinate system was very simple. It was del square by del x square plus del square by del y square plus del square by del z square. But now, Laplacian in the spherical cylindrical coordinate system, as most of the students complain that it's very difficult to remember, I have a simple solution to that. I will actually make it simplified, you know, by considering another coordinate system which is called general orthogonal coordinate system. I will give you the expression for the Laplacian in the general orthogonal coordinate system. That would be very simple, very simple. Once you know that, you can deduce it for even for Cartesian spherical and cylindrical coordinate system. The expression is very simple in the general orthogonal coordinate system, Laplacian expression. You can always deduce it for spherical and cylindrical coordinate system. So what is this, by the way, what is this general orthogonal coordinate system? See, basically this general orthogonal coordinate system is basically extension of the Cartesian coordinates. Cartesian coordinates have x, y, z. I want to extend it to a new coordinate system. We'll call it general orthogonal coordinate system. How do I do that? So you assume a new coordinate system where the coordinates are a1, a2, a3. a1, a2, a3 are the new coordinates in the new coordinate system, and a1 is a function of x, y, z, a2 is a function of x, y, z, a3 is also a function of x, y, z. X, y, z are the coordinates for the Cartesian coordinate system for which we are doing the extension. So general coordinate, orthogonal coordinate system will have coordinates a1, a2 and a3. In the Cartesian coordinate system, it was x, y, z. We are trying to extend Cartesian coordinate system to a general orthogonal coordinate system. So now here, it will have three axes, just like in Cartesian coordinate system, you have three axes, x axis, y axis, z axis here. Here also you'll have three axes, a1, a2, a3. Along a1, a2, a3, and the direction of unit vector along a1 axis, a2 axis and a3 axis will be denoted by a1 hat, a2 hat and a3 hat. Hat actually is for the unit vector. So this is a unit vector along the a1 axis, that is a1 hat. Unit vector along the a2 axis is a2 hat. Unit vector along the a3 axis is a3 hat. So now, and there is one condition here, this unit vector should be perpendicular to each other. That's why the name, no, orthogonal. This unit vector a1 hat, a2 hat, and a3 hat should be perpendicular to each other. So the new coordinate system is called orthogonal curvilinear coordinate system. Orthogonal curvilinear coordinate system. For example, you can consider cylindrical coordinate system, which is a particular case of this orthogonal curvilinear coordinate system. So in the cylindrical coordinate system, what are the variables we have? So let's consider that XYZ is a Cartesian coordinate system. I want to extend it to orthogonal coordinate system. New orthogonal coordinate system, which is called cylindrical coordinate system. So I draw a cylinder and I find a radius of the cylinder, that is called rho variable. That's the first coordinate for the cylindrical coordinate system, rho. Rho is the first variable for the cylindrical coordinate system. We also know angle rho max with the x-axis is phi. So phi is the next coordinate. And the height of the cylinder is z. So this is a cylindrical coordinate system. It has coordinates as rho, phi, and z. So now, that means this is a particular case of the orthogonal curvilinear coordinate system where your a1 is rho, a2 is phi, a3 is z. So orthogonal curvilinear coordinate system is a general coordinate system. One particular case of that is cylindrical coordinate system in which a1 is rho, a2 is phi, and a3 is z. Similarly, a1 hat will become rho hat, a2 hat will become phi hat, and a3 hat will become z hat. So cylindrical coordinate system is a particular case of the orthogonal curvilinear coordinate system in which a1 is rho, a2 is phi, and a3 is z. We can also see that basically we have done the extension of the Cartesian coordinate system. We can always find a relation between the Cartesian and cylindrical coordinate system. So obviously, looking at the diagram here, we have in the right hand side, I can always find out what is x, y, z. What is x? X is rho of cosine of phi. Y is rho of, look at the diagram here, rho of sine of phi. J and z is equal. So we can find the relation between the Cartesian and cylindrical coordinate system. X turns out to be rho of cosine of phi. Y turns out to be rho of sine of phi. Z is equal to z. So this relation between the Cartesian and cylindrical coordinate system. So when I extend the Cartesian coordinate system to a general curvilinear coordinate system, there is some factor which is called scale factor, which will scale the all the coordinates. Because of this scale factor, there will be some scaling in all the coordinates. We usually denote this scale factor by scale factor 1 s1, scale factor 2 s2, and scale factor s3. We need to know this scale factor s1, s2, and s3 so that we can deduce the Laplacian in the general curvilinear coordinate system into particular case of cylindrical coordinate system, Cartesian coordinate system, or spherical coordinate system. So we'll require this scale factor S1, S2, S3 for different coordinate system when we actually want to write the Laplacian in the particular coordinate system. So basically it gives a measure of how a change in coordinate changes the position of a point. So that's the physical meaning of the scale factor. Let us try to calculate this scale factor because we'll be using it for the Laplacian in the different coordinate system. Let's say I want to write the Laplacian in the cylindrical coordinate system, then I need to find the scale factor for the cylindrical coordinate system, because in the Laplacian expression we'll see in the following slides that scale factor is also present. So we need to know what is the scale factor for different coordinate system. So we already know the relation between Cartesian and cylindrical coordinates. From there you can find the scale factors. You know that x is rho of cosine phi, y is rho of sine phi, z is z. So from here I can always find the scale factor. Scale factor is defined, let's say scale factor 1 is defined as square root of dou x by dou rho square plus dou y by dou rho square plus dou z by dou rho square. I know what is the relation between x is simply rho of cosine of phi, so I can find dou rho by dou x by dou rho. I know that y is rho of sine of phi. I can find dou y by dou rho. I know z is equal to z. I can find dou z by dou rho. So from there, I can find the scale factor. So scale factor for this particular case, for the cylindrical coordinate system, scale factor 1 is simply turns out to be 1. You can also find the scale factor 2. It can be found out as dou x by dou phi square plus dou y by dou phi square, dou z by dou phi square, square root of that. So when you find it out, you have the relation between the x, y, z and the rho phi and z. So you can just find it out as a very simple derivation, turns out to be rho. Similarly, you can find the scale factor 3 for the cylindrical coordinate system. That will be dou x by dou z square plus dou y by dou z square plus dou z by dou z square, square root of that, so it turns out to be 1. So I simply remember it, scale factor for the cylindrical coordinate system is 1 rho 1. That's it. This is the derivation. If you are interested, you can always do it yourself, derive it yourself. But all we need for this course is scale factor for cylindrical coordinate system is 1 rho 1. Spherical coordinate system also, we want to write Laplacian in cylindrical coordinate system. For that, you need to know the scale factor. Similarly, for the spherical coordinate system also, I want to write the Laplacian in the spherical coordinate system so that I can find the solution of the wave equation in the spherical coordinate system. For that, I need to know the scale factor for the spherical coordinate system also. So let's look at the spherical coordinate system. I already introduced you to the spherical coordinate system in the last class. Let's say this is xyz. xyz. So there should be a z here. So x, y, and z. So for the spherical coordinate system, first variable is r. R is the position vector. It's the distance from the origin to the point, any arbitrary point here. This is the position vector, r. So this position vector r max with the angle, this position vector r max with the z axis is called theta. So theta is that. You take the projection of this r vector along the xy plane, then angle this projection max with the x axis called phi. So r, theta and phi are the variables for the spherical coordinate system. As I already told you, spherical coordinate system is also a particular case of a general curvilinear orthogonal system. So what was the variable for general curvilinear orthogonal system? A1, A2, A3. So A1, A2, A3 for spherical system will now become r, theta and phi. Similarly, A1 hat will become r hat, A2 hat will become theta hat, A3 hat will become phi hat. We can also find out the relation between Cartesian and the spherical coordinate system. You can clearly find out from this diagram we have here. So basically, what is z? Z is r cos of theta. Z is r cos of theta from here. And what is this line here? This is r sine theta. You take cosine of phi of that, you get x. R sine theta cosine of phi. You take this line is r sine theta. You take sine phi of that, you get y axis. So y is equal to r sine theta sine phi. So x is r sine theta cos phi, y is r sine theta sine phi, and z is r cosine of theta. From this diagram, you can easily derive this relation. But we are interested in the calculation of the scale factor because scale factors are used in the expression for the Laplacian of the spherical coordinate system. It's the same formula you have here. S1 will be square root of dou x by dou r square, dou x by dou r whole square, dou plus dou y by dou r whole square plus dou z by dou r whole square. So you have the relation x, y, z here. You take the partial derivative respect to x, r for this, partial derivative respect to r for this, partial derivative respect to r for this, then you get that first is s scale factor 1 is 1. And scale factor 2 is dou x by dou theta whole square plus dou y by dou theta whole square, dou z by dou theta whole square, square root of that. So you do the partial derivative of this, this and this, take square and sum up, then take square root, you get r. Similarly, you can find the scale factor 3, dou x by dou phi whole square plus dou y by dou phi whole square plus dou z by dou phi whole square, square root. Take the square root of that. That means basically you take the partial derivative of this expression with respect to phi, square of that, add with the partial derivative of this respect to phi, then square of that, add with the partial derivative of this respect to phi and add, then take the square root, finally you get r sine theta. So what I do is I just remember scale factor for the spherical coordinate is simply 1 r r sine theta, that's how I just remember it, 1 r r sine theta. This is required for finding the Laplacian in the spherical coordinate system, 1 r r sine theta. Okay, so let's look at the expression for a Laplacian of a scalar function. So let's say psi is a scalar function, del square is a Laplacian. So the expression you have here is this. I will try to explain this expression one by one in the next slide. So this is the expression you have. So basically what we are doing is we want to find the Laplacian for Cartesian, spherical and the cylindrical coordinate system. I have just reduced it to one equation in the general curvilinear coordinate system. You just need to know this one equation, then you can deduce it for the three coordinate system. And we'll see that in the next slide, this equation here for the Laplacian of a scalar function is very simple to remember. I will tell you how to remember it in the next slide. Just now we have derived the different coordinate system, Cartesian, cylindrical and spherical coordinate system is a particular case of the general curvilinear coordinate system. In the general curvilinear coordinate system, what are the variables? A1, A2, A3 are the coordinates we have, A1, A2, A3, and scale factors was S1, S2, S3. In the Cartesian coordinate system, coordinates are X, Y and Z, and since we are extending Cartesian coordinate system to general curvilinear coordinate system, for the Cartesian coordinate system I don't have any scale factors. I have scale factors, but they are equal to 1 because we are extending Cartesian coordinate system to a general curvilinear coordinate system. For the extension from Cartesian coordinate system to Cartesian coordinate system itself, I don't want any scale factor. Scale factor should be always equal to 1. Is the same Cartesian coordinate system, we are extending it, for that we are multiplying by we are actually using this scale factor S1, S2, S3, so that I get the general curvilinear coordinate system. But this is Cartesian coordinate itself, then scale factor should be equal to 1. For the cylindrical coordinate system, the variables or the coordinates were rho, phi and z. Scale factors we have derived with 1 rho 1. For the spherical coordinate system, the variables were r theta, this should be phi here, this should be phi, this is a typo here, r theta and phi, r theta and phi, and the scale factor was 1 r r sine theta. So we have all the variables and their scale factor for the three coordinate system, which is a particular case of the general curvilinear coordinate system. Let us go to the Laplacian. So Laplacian is what we are interested in finding for the three coordinate system. We have already done for Cartesian coordinate system. We want to do it for cylindrical and spherical coordinate system, but I want to take this as a particular case of the general curvilinear coordinate system so that the equation of the Laplacian is much more simplified. Let's look at the equation for the Laplacian of psi. Psi is any scalar function. First thing is that, what do you see here? What you see here is outside this third bracket, what do you have? This is 1 by S1, S2, S3. S1, S2, S3 are the scale factor of the any particular coordinate system. So what we are seeing is that outside the bracket, we have 1 by product of all the scale factors. This is the first thing you need to notice. Inside the bracket, how many terms are there? There are 3 terms. This is the first term, second term, third term. And we'll see that once you know the first term, you can always write the second term and third term. So in a way, you don't need to know the second term and third term. You just know the first term, second and third term automatically can be written. So in a way, we are actually reducing the Laplacian to just one single term. You just know one single term of the Laplacian, then you can write the Laplacian for this general curvilinear coordinate system. Then once you have that, you deduce it for Cartesian, cylindrical or spherical coordinate system. So It's very simple. So basically, Laplacian of psi in general curvilinear coordinate system, the first thing we noticed was outside the third bracket, we have 1 by product of all the scale factor. Inside the bracket, you have 3 terms. We'll just consider this first term and look closely. So look at the first term here. What do you have here? Dou by dou A1. So basically, you are doing partial derivative with respect to A1. And what do you have here inside the first bracket here? What do you have? This term here, look at this. This term here is the product of the scale factor of the remaining axis. So first term is for the, let's say first term is for the first axis A1. So we are doing partial derivative with respect to dou by dou A1. But here, this scale factor you are multiplying is for the remaining axis, that is A2 and A3, so S2, S3. And what we are dividing is the scale factor of the present axis. So S1 is what we are dividing. So dou by dou A1, S2, S3 is the product of remaining scale factor divided by product of divided by scale factor of the present axis. Then we also have another term here, which is basically dou by dou A1, that is the partial derivative with respect to the A1 variable. So what we have observed is outside the bracket, we have 1 by S1, S2, S3. This is dou by dou A1, S2, S3 by S1, dou by dou A1 of psi. So the first term is clear, the second term is exactly same. Same procedure you can follow. The second term would be dou by dou A2. Then product of the remaining axis, that would be S1, S3 divided by present axis is scale factor for the present axis is S2. So product of the scale factor of the remaining axis, so it is S1, S3 and divided by the present axis, which is S2, scale factor of the present axis. So S1, S3 divided by S2, dou by dou A2 of psi. Similarly, here also dou by dou A3, product of the scale factor of the remaining axis, that is S1, S2, and divided by scale factor of the present axis S3, dou by dou A3 psi. So this formula is very simple. So Laplacian, you just need to know one term, and you can always write similarly in the, for the second and third term, and you can easily remember this formula. I mean, very simple. So once we have this, you can deduce the expression for Laplacian for the other coordinate system. So this is Laplacian you have for the general curvilinear coordinate system. I can write it for Cartesian coordinate. Simple, no? Cartesian coordinate, all the scale factors were 1. Because we have extended this general curvilinear coordinate system from the Cartesian coordinate system. So all the scale factors were 1. So 1 by 1. So we have 1 here outside the bracket. Inside the bracket, what is A1? A1 is x. Scale factors are all 1. This term will go away. So dou by dou x. Dou by dou x psi. So that is dou square by dou x square psi. So here also you can see A2 is y. So dou by dou y, dou by dou y. These are 1. So dou square psi by dou y square. A3 is z. So S1, S2, S3 all are 1. So dou by dou z, dou by dou z psi. So dou square psi by dou z square. That's how you get the Cartesian coordinate system. You can also do similarly for the cylindrical coordinate system, because I know the scale factors, I know the coordinates for the cylindrical coordinate system. I just substitute in this equation here. What are the scale factors for the cylindrical coordinate system? 1 row 1. So 1 by row. What do I have? 1 by row here. See, this first coordinate was row. So del by del row, del by del row. What are the scale factors? 1 row 1. So rho into 1 divided by 1. So I have rho here. So del by del rho, rho dou psi by dou rho here. What is the second coordinate? Phi. So we have phi here, phi here. Scale factors 1 rho 1. So 1 into 1 divided by rho. So 1 by rho here. Then what is the third coordinate? Third coordinate is z. Del by del z, del by del z. Scale factor 1 rho 1. So 1 into rho divided by 1. So you have this here. You can even simplify it. This is the expression you have for the Laplacian in the spherical coordinate system in the cylindrical coordinate system, and many students find it really difficult to remember this formula. But this equation, you just need to remember only this term here and what do you have in the outside the bracket. And this term can be easily remembered from the memory tips I have given you in the previous slide. Once you remember this, you can write this and just substitute scale factor and coordinates for different coordinate system such as Cartesian coordinate, cylindrical coordinate. You can easily do it for spherical coordinate system also. What are the scale factor for spherical coordinate system? 1 r sin theta. So this will become 1 by r square sin theta. So del by del r is the first coordinate. So here it will be dou by dou r. And what are the scale factor? 1 r sin theta. So r square sin theta by 1. Similarly here, del by del theta. Theta is the next coordinate. So del by del theta. What are the scale factor? 1 r sin theta. So r sin theta divided by r. This is what you have here. Similarly, what is the next coordinate? Phi. Del by. So this will become del by del phi. Del by del phi. 1 r sin theta. So r by r sin theta. So this is what you have. You can simplify it. This is the expression you have for the Laplacian in the spherical coordinate system. It's very difficult to remember for many people, but this one is quite easy. Once you know this, first term you can write, second, third, and you know the scale factor, you know the coordinates for different coordinate system, you can substitute it. This is a very easy way of remembering the Laplacian. So we have the Laplacian in the cylindrical and spherical coordinate system. Once we have this, we can solve it for the cylindrical coordinate system and spherical coordinate system. What kind of waves we'll get for different coordinate system like cylindrical and spherical coordinate system, we'll see in the next class. We already find out the wave equation for the Cartesian coordinates and it turns out to be plane waves. That's all for this class. Hope to see you in the next class.